Amen. Hallelujah. Can other ushers gather everyone in this place this morning? We're going to have church. Yes. Amen. Did you hear me? We're going to have church this morning. We're going to have church. In the prayer room, I felt so full in my spirit. I felt such a deepness in my stomach. And this morning, you may have came empty. You may have came with nothing. But this morning, I'm praying we're going to believe that the Holy Spirit begins to fill you up this morning, that He's going to overflow our cups. Our cups are going to be overflowed with the Holy Spirit. And come on, if you believe that this morning, we're going to begin to worship. And we're going to believe that there is freedom in the name of Jesus. That He came to set every captive free. He came to bring liberty. All the sin, all of everything. He is alive through it all. He is alive. So where the Spirit of the Lord is in this place. There is freedom. So if you came and you felt bound, there is a spirit of freedom in this place, that whatever chain that you have, whatever spirit that's holding you back, it is going to be broken. And we're going to come together, because when two or more are gathered, miracles, signs, and wonders begin to appear. Hallelujah.
You came to set the captives free. You came to bring us liberty. My sin and my rejection met. Your blood and my acceptance. And now I'm alive to bring you praise. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom, and every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. Whoa. Whoa. Your blood has covered every sin. Your grace empowers me to win. My pain and my oppression met. Your blood and my acceptance. And now I'm alive to bring you praise. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, the Spirit of the Lord is. Where the Spirit of the Lord is. Where the Spirit of the Lord is. Let every chain. Cause where the Spirit, cause where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Oh, come on, give your Lord a hand clap this morning. Hallelujah. Father, we're so grateful this morning, God, that it's your throne of mercy and grace that I can lay myself on it every single day. And at your throne, God, there's healing. There's healing in your throne room this morning. Come on, we're gonna sing this song this morning.
Dream after dream, you are speaking to me. You're breathing word after word of kingdom. Here at your feet, I can see the unseen, and truly one look at you and I'm undone. And I run to the throne room, I run to the throne room, and I fall on my face with angels and saints, and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you. And my heart can't contain the weight of your name, and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you. Grace upon grace, all my fears washed away, and only your perfect love for me remains. And time after time, you stay close by my side. Your burning fire inside, I can't contain.
Come on, we're gonna run.
And I run to the throne room. I run to the throne room. And I fall on my face with angels and saints. And all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you, God. And my heart can't contain the weight of your name, and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you. And I run to the throne room, I run to the throne room.
Come on, what about running to his feet, running at his feet and laying it all down, Jesus. We're laying it all down this morning, God. Come on, every expectation, God. I don't know what you came for this morning, but he's got it for you this morning. Come on, but our God is not like a microwave. Come on, God, you have a process. You have a way that you do things, God. So we're just gonna keep running and running to your throne room. Come on.
And I'll run to the throne room before you, the only one. I run to the throne room before you, I'm overcome. I run to the throne room before you, the only one. I run to the throne room before you, I'm overcome. and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you, God. When my heart can't contain the weight of your name, and all I can say is holy, holy are you. We say holy, holy, holy are you. I say holy, holy, holy are you. Come on, our God is holy. Our God is holy. We serve a sovereign God. He's the ruler of it all. Father, we give you reverence this morning, God. We don't come casually, God. Come on, in our prayer room this morning, somebody said, I felt like somebody was right next to me. Do we even know when he's in the room anymore? Lord, awaken us to know that you're in this room. That you're in this place. You were already here before we even got here, Father. That's how good you are.
And I fall on my face with angels and saints, and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you, God. And my heart can't contain the weight of your name, and all I can say is holy, holy, holy are you.
Psalm 66:5-7. Come and see what our God has done. What awesome miracles he performs for people. He made a dry path through the Red Sea, and his people went across on foot. There we rejoiced in him. For by his great power, he rules forever. He watches every movement of the nations. Let no rebel rise in defiance.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, you're touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You mended every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise darkness, my God.
Jesus right now. If you have been touched by God, if you have been changed, if you have been set free, your chains falling off, give them a shout out to God. Jesus! Come on, church. This is not the time to be quiet. You men out there, raise your voice, men. Raise your voice, men. Raise your voice, men. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. This is not a time to be quiet. Amen. We need to buckle down, put on our pants. This is not a time to run and hide in this world right now. We need to stand firm on His word. Amen. For all the craziness that's going on in this world today, we need to put on our big boy pants. Stand on His word. And do not fear. Be strong and courageous, men. Women, be strong and courageous. I know you women are. Amen. I want to lift up our pastors. I want to lift up Evangelist Rudy Menchaca. Amen. For the Holy Spirit to be on him. For our Heavenly Father's words to be flowing through him, through his lips. Thank you, Lord, for him and his ministry. I pray wisdom and a vision, and Lord, I pray hedge of protection around him. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in his life and through him, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I want to pray over our teachers and our children in the back, amen, that the Holy Spirit will be on them as well, that the patience will be on them, amen, that their words, our Lord's words, will be on their lips, teaching our children. And also our parents, amen. The parents in here are to be discipling their children. Day in and day out. Parents, watch what you do. Watch what you say, parents. You are the one that are teaching them. It is not the youth leader. It is not the pastors that are teaching your children. It is you, parents. Amen. Let's lift up this service. I want to pray for all Christians everywhere. All Christians everywhere to be steadfast. And where they're at, through persecution, through hate, whatever is going on in their lives and around them, that they will be steadfast on His word. Amen. Let's lift them up. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this place, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this world. There's a lot of hurt, Lord. There's a lot of hate, Father God. But when there is no way, Father God, you make a way, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing, that you will make a way, Lord, and we trust in you, Lord. I want to lift up our pastors, Lord, the set man and set woman, Lord. I pray for vision and wisdom, Lord, and protection around them, Lord, Father God. A fresh fire on them. And Evangelist Rudy Menchaca, Lord, thank you for him, Lord. A fresh fire today, Father God. Thank you, Lord. I pray for the hearts in here, Lord, to be ready, to be ready, to be ready for the word today. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the honor, Lord, and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we all shout and say, amen and amen. Greet your neighbor from where you are. Amen. Give him a high five from a distance. An air hug. Amen. An air hug. You remember those? What is that? Virtual hugs. Send your hearts on online. Amen. Put your comments in the comment sections. Thank you for those of you that are watching online. Oh, you want me to go down there? I'll go down there. Amen. Yeah, that's for me. Thank you. This is me. Thank you. I appreciate it, brothers. Thank you for your servanthood. Amen. Amen. Woo! Got an ab workout right there. Amen. Amen. The Lord is working. Amen. He's working me out. He's working us out. He's ironing. He's working me out. Amen. Amen. How many are glad to be here this morning? Amen. Amen. How many went out to outreach yesterday evening? It was a powerful time, amen. It was kind of quiet until the food got there, and then we were able to impart to people, amen, spiritually and with the food also, to give to them, that community there. It was an awesome time, amen. People are in need, amen. They might not seem like it. It might be quiet. We just got to tug on them and give the word to them, amen. Amen. On this Wednesday service, we have at 7 p.m., we have service, amen, and our prayers at 6 p.m. We will be selling arroz con leche, amen. Woo, you like my Spanish there, nice, amen. Arroz con leche, my favorite, amen. A slice of pan dulce, how you like that? Woo. For $5, amen, we're doing this to raise some money for our next outreach, December 12th, amen, to that same community. We want to bless them. We want to bless them physically with toys, the kids with toys, with some supplies that they might need and some food, amen. So please get involved, amen. And also Sunday, next Sunday, we'll have a bowl of pozole with a drink for $7. So please come out hungry. Spiritually, you like that, huh, Joe? Come out hungry for the word, spiritually and physically, amen. And also be ready to give, amen. Amen. For that church outreach, all church outreach on December 12th, we'll be raising $1,000, amen. It's a toy giveaway to all the children there. We're trying to raise as much as we can. If you have any toys that your kids are not using, any toys that you want to buy and donate, we have a box in the back that you can put all the toys in, amen? And if you want to give cash or money, you can see Brother Steve here or Brother David, amen? Brother David, amen. I forgot your name. Morales, thank you. David Morales, amen. Raising $1,000, we want to see God move, amen? Amen. Woo! And also, For the Wednesday right before Thanksgiving, we're having a praise report Wednesday, amen. So if any of you want to give a quick praise report, amen. You can sign up with Sister Irene, and we're gonna have some treats and stuff. You can sign up with Sister Lena, amen. Amen. It's gonna be a powerful time. I love hearing the praise reports around that time. Amen. God is moving in His people, and it gives you the chance to express it to the church. Amen. Amen. So please sign up with Sister Irene. Amen. Amen. How many are ready to give? Amen. Amen. You can give. Text to give 714-710-1981, and we have a couple more ways to give. Powerhouseoc.org, amen. And also you can call nearly anytime, 562-298-7145, amen. So please get ready to give as we're speaking. And if you need to give through the envelope, please raise your hand and one of our servants will get that to you, amen. Amen. Ooh. So Paul right here is in Corinthians, he's trying to build their faith in Corinthians, amen, in the church of Corinth, amen. And he tells them in 16:1, 1 Corinthians 16:1, now regarding your question about the money being collected for God's people, you should follow the same procedure I gave to the churches in Galatia. On the first day of each week, you should each put aside a portion of the money you have earned. Amen. On the first day of each week, you should put aside a portion of what you have earned. Amen. Don't wait. Don't wait until I get there and then try to collect it all at once. Don't wait, he says. Don't wait. Give. Don't wait to get noticed. Don't wait for the spiritual man of God or woman of God to get there to make it seem like you're... Don't wait, amen. Matthew 6, 3 and 4. Don't wait. Don't wait. Excuse me. Don't wait to make it seem like, okay, amen. Matthew 6, 3, 4. Here, let me try again. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Give your gifts privately, and your Father who sees everything will reward you. Amen. Amen. And God's priorities are very different from the world's. Amen. God is clearly more interested in our quiet servanthood, in our quiet giving. Amen. He's not looking for us to blow the trumpet when we're giving. He's not interested in gathering everybody. Watch. Selfie, watch me give this to this person. Hey. He's not interested in all that. That right there is your own reward. But give without even letting your left hand know what the right hand is doing. Forget about it and give. Forget about it. Come on now. Amen. Amen. Let's give this morning cheerfully. Now is the time to give. We're getting into the season. It's a giving time, but people are getting lonely. People are getting, people are broken down. People need it. Give without wanting to be seen. Amen? Amen. Let's go ahead and pray for today's offering. Amen. Once again, you can text to give 714-710-1981. Powerhouseoc.org, and that number again is 562-298-7145. Amen. Amen. Let's pray for today's offering. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you. Whew. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this place, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for every heart in here, Lord. I pray for changed hearts today, Lord. I pray for revelation, Lord. I pray for salvation, Lord. But concerning today's offering, Lord, I ask that you bless this offering, Lord. Multiply it, Lord, Father God. Have it go forth into your kingdom, Lord. Whatever you desire it to go through, go to, Father God. We trust in you, Lord. We give it all to you, Lord. We give it all to you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We give you all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we all shout and say, amen and amen.
When the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. And where the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. The heavy chain is broken through you, Jesus. And where the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. Whoa.
Amen. Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing this morning? Amen. We want to welcome you to Powerhouse. And if this is your first time, amen, we're glad to see you today. And we always like to say that if you don't have a home church, we pray that you would consider this church to be your home church. Amen. We're excited to be here this morning. We're excited to have our guest speaker with us. I know you're going to be blessed. He's a good friend of mine. Amen. We've known each other for a long time. Amen. So he's been a blessing to our church. God always moves and uses him in a mighty way here. And I know that God is going to do something special. And so I pray that your hearts are open. You came expecting and believing. And so I believe that if you did that, you're not going to leave disappointed. Amen. So let's give him a big powerhouse welcome as Evangelist Rudy Menchaca comes and ministers.
Here I am. Give God one more praise. Come on, give him a good praise. He's in this house, amen. He's going to help us today. It's so exciting to be here with you. I am constantly bragging and boasting about this church. And there's no question God's about to take this church to the next level in Jesus' name. And it's not just to do it, there's a purpose. Because I'm blessed to be an evangelist, and I'm in a different church every 2-3 days. And what's missing in the church really is the power of God. Miracles are missing. And we're lacking that in Jesus' name. But I do believe strongly, I'm not just saying it to say it, I believe God is about to restore his wonder-working power to his church. And he's going to start with this church in Jesus' name. You ought to shout, because God's about to do something powerful in your life. And I was praying for you this morning, and the Lord gave me, I said, Lord, give me a word for the pastor, for the church. And he gave me one word. It's called acceleration. You're about to take off. Later with the virus. Don't even trip on that. That's a lie out of hell. God is still on the throne. He's still in control. And so get ready, get ready, get ready. And I would charge you under the anointing of God to contend for revival, to not allow division to creep in, to stay like-minded. Don't stab each other in the back. Because God will remove whoever is a stumbling block. So be careful when you pray. Say, Lord, remove the people that are causing drama. You might be gone. So I'm here to tell you, because I love you, come on now, that God is doing a mighty work here. I mean a powerful work. You guys are going to set an example for many other churches. You really are. But you're going to have to fight to keep it. And let me say one last thing before I preach. Okay? Be careful that you don't confuse Pentecost for crazy. Because Pentecost draws the crazy. And people start doing things that aren't God. And they're out of order. And we need to step up to these people, those of us that are in authority, and pull them aside and say, don't be doing that in the church no more. It's out of order, brother. Or sister, can you say amen? And so I'm just charging you because I know God's going to do something tremendous. If you have your Bibles, Luke chapter 24, we're going to start in verse 1. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Who's ready for a miracle? Come on, who's ready? Chapter 24, verse 1. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid, and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And he remembered the words of Jesus. Amen. Powerful story that I pray God will give you revelation today, and understand that what is missing in the house are miracles. I'm not against the worship. I'm not against the shouting and the dancing. The Bible says, shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. If you have a problem with the shouting and say, that's a little ridiculous, then you need to find another place, or you need to get right with God. Because the Bible says, shout unto the Lord. Don't be quiet. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Enter his courts with thanksgiving and praise. So I'm not against all that, but we need miracles. We're lacking miracles. Can you say amen? I'm not talking somewhat. I'm talking bona fide miracles where we can testify of what God is doing. The problem with that is that I've been studying miracles now for some time, probably 2 years. I've been blessed to be on the road for about 17 years now. And God's been doing a lot of healing, inner healings. Hearts and minds get healed. Come on now. And by the grace of God, it's not man. I tell people the beauty of what I do is that I can get in my car and drive away and it doesn't matter because I'm not doing the healing. But I've been saying, Lord, I want to go deeper. Come on. I want to see some physical healings. Because I know guys like Benny Hitt and other guys, they're not going to come here. We can't afford them. So make me the Mexican, Benny Hinn. And give us miracles in Jesus' name. So I've been studying miracles for years now. And I've seen, you know, one here, one there, one here, one there. I saw one this week, actually. A young girl, my niece, actually, I got a call saying, you know, pray for her. She's going in for surgery on Monday. Her spine is all crooked. I've got the x-rays in my phone. They said it'll never get straight. They cannot straighten it. And when it's over, she may not even be able to walk. And so I get a call saying, Uncle, you're not going to believe it, but her back is perfectly straight. Then I get a call the day after, Uncle, you're not going to believe it. You're going to believe it, Uncle, but she's walking already. I'm here to tell you God's a healer. But it takes faith to believe. So I'm studying miracles. Show me, Lord, talk to me. You know what I find interesting? Most miracle services last about 4 hours. And I'm like, getting people to stay in church for 4 hours is a miracle in itself. I mean, we're so used to an hour and a half. You know, we're used to our 20, 25-minute worship. Our announcements are offering. And, dude, don't go over 35 minutes because I got some stuff I got to do. But meanwhile, you're hurting, but you're still in a hurry. Hurting it in a hurry. Hurting it in a hurry. And you don't realize that sometimes it takes time for God to move. It takes time. So we're going to make time today. I'm going to try to preach as fast as I can, but I got so much stuff to give you. But before I even, this is, I don't want to sound insulting, but before you even get healed, sometimes we got to break through the mind. Are you hearing me today? You got to break through the mind and understand what God really wants to do. Now the Bible says this. It says this in Hebrews 11:1. Now faith, I got all kinds of notes over here, man. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's up to your faith this morning to say, my faith is going to work now. Because the scripture says now faith. It doesn't say tomorrow faith. It doesn't say down the road faith. It says now faith. Now faith. So if you need a miracle now, then you need to start. I'm getting my miracle today in Jesus' name. The problem lies is that as Christians, we've come up many, many times for our miracles. Proverbs 13:12 says, hope deferred maketh the heart sick. But when desire cometh, it is a tree of life. Now stay with me because I really want to help you. And I see a lot of young people and you may think, well, I'm here. I don't need no healing. Well, you ain't going to stay young forever, homeboy. Oh, yes, you're not. And someday your body's going to hurt. And if you don't put this sermon in your pocket someday, you will be deceived by the enemy. And you'll live in pain for the rest of your life because you don't really believe God can heal you. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. So what happens is, because you didn't get healed the last time. Come on. Now, please listen. You've grown comfortable with your pain. Woo! You've learned to embrace your affliction. And you've learned to settle where you are. No longer do you believe God can still heal. Wow. You're convinced. Well, this is my thorn in the flesh. And I will serve you, and you get all religious, and I'll serve you no matter what, God. No, God wants to heal you. I'm throwing stuff out. I hope you're catching it. I'm trying to preach slow, but I can't do it. But we settle for relief instead of removal. Hope you're listening. You settle for relief. Lord, if you could just stop the pain a little bit, oh, I'd be so thankful, God. But it hurts so bad. If you could just stop it. You know what Jesus said? If you speak to that mountain to be cast into the sea, it'll be done. For with God, nothing is impossible. Now, what is whole mindset of casting a mountain into the sea? Please get this revelation that when that mountain disappears in the sea, please listen, you'll never see it again. And God wants your pain. He wants you to never see it again. He wants you to never feel it again. Can you say amen? Oh, I hope you're paying attention. Because as I stand here preaching, our churches this morning are full of men and women my age or older. I'm 63. That wake up in the morning every day to about 15 bottles of medication. Some of you wake up to a couple of bottles already. But the question I have for you that God has for you is, are you willing to continue to wake up tomorrow to medication? Or do you want to wake up tomorrow to a miracle? I'm trying to talk slow because I want you to catch it. Because you got to change the way you think. Can you say amen? You got to build the miracle mentality this morning. And when we open the altars, I am not praying for any one of you. Because I don't want you to say, you know, Pastor came and laid hands on me and God healed me. I ain't taking no glory from God. We're going to open the altar. You're going to come get your healing. Whether it be physical, mental, emotional, God's going to heal you today. Today is going to be a turning point for your life. You ought to get excited because today is going to be a turning point in your life. See, some of you don't have pain that's just, you know, don't let you sleep at night, but you're still hurting in certain areas of your life. This knee bothers me sometimes. Come on, somebody. My neck, man. Every now and then I get these headaches, but not all the time. How about we get rid of them once and for all? Try to talk slow. You get sick and you go straight home when you start feeling something isn't right in your body because your body will talk to you. So you go home and you jump on the internet. Now please listen. And you spend a whole day looking for symptoms. What would happen if you spent all day looking for scriptures? You're using all your time looking for symptoms, and then the devil lies to you. I have that. I have that too. I have that too. Oh my. I'm about to get worse. How about scriptures? I am the God that healeth thee. I have sent my word and healed your disease, saith the Lord. For by his stripes you are healed in Jesus' name. Telling you, God wants to help us today. See, you read the story of the woman who bled for 12 years. And see, it's right in our faces and we don't catch it. You know why? Because we've learned to live with pain. We've learned to just say, it's just the way of life, brother. And listen to the lie of hell. Well, you're getting old, sis. There's nothing you can do about it. You know, learn to walk like this. You're going to be all right, but praise God, you can still walk. Charlie, I want to walk right. Come on now. The woman bled for 12 years. You, how many know that? You've read the story? She spent all that she had and only got worse. I have so many things to say to you today, and I hope you're catching it. I have a picture on my phone of a doctor getting ready to work with his new doctors that are getting ready to become doctors. And on the screen, he has a picture, and it says, the patient healed is the customer lost. Did you hear that? You're not awake? So, I'm going to keep you on medication. Oh, yeah. And I don't even know if it works. But I'm going to tell you, why don't we try this? We'll see if it works. I have another picture where the woman goes to the pharmacist and she says, what are the symptoms of this medication? Oh, let me see. It says here it will cause bankruptcy. Huh? Gonna take all your money. All your money when there's a God that heals. Now, I saw all the women and people shouting, and I'm not against that. Don't get mad at me. But you need miracles, too. Not just zeal. We need miracles, can you say amen? The devil came to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He's stealing money from God's children, and they're spending it on medication. You ain't hearing me. And vitamins and all this bellow. Come on now. Come on, taking your money. You know none of that stuff works. Taking all your money, and you know what the scripture says. The devil came to kill, and guess what? Now you're spending so much money on your medication, you can't tithe. Pastor, I wanted to give to that $1,000 plus, but I had to buy this air, you know, the freshener for my house to clear the air. Because shut up. Because I have allergies. I'm trying to slow down. Because the devil's robbing God's people. And we're letting him. I have another picture that says, Doctor, when will we find the cure for this disease? Well, simple, son. When we find the cure for greed. Because it's a trillion-dollar industry. You know how much money people spend on medication? I hope you're listening today. And if you're the one that's spending the money, that's okay, because after today, you're not going to spend it no more. And I'm not telling you before I'm done, go home, flush all your stuff. I'm not telling you that. But how about adding a little faith today to your life? How about going home, and if you're diabetic and you're whatever medication you're on, you cut it in half and you test yourself. And you eat right. Because God's going to heal diabetes today. Oh, yes, he is. But that don't give you the right to get out of here dancing in the Holy Ghost. I've been delivered, praise the Lord. Okay, well, you don't go straight to 7-Eleven, buy a big Slurpee, bunch of cookies, and take a sugar, and you're working against the miracle. You got to work with it. Can you say amen? Amen? Listen to me. You ain't going to stay young forever, baby. You're not. But if you just do what God's trying to help us today, signs and wonders is what we need. It's the title of my message. Listen, signs and wonders. A sign is what you see, and a wonder is what you're going to feel. It'll leave you wondering at you what you just saw. Wow. You go home today and you'll see a billboard for Carl's. The new quadruple burger. It's called the heart attack. And you go, I wonder what that tastes like. You saw it? Now you're wondering. You saw it? You saw it? And now you're wondering. In our text, they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. And they entered in and found not the body of Christ. God's trying to give you revelation today. The stone was not rolled away so Jesus could get out. It was rolled away so they could walk in. And they could see. They could see, and it left them in wonder. Where is he? See, God just rolled the stone away from some of your minds and gave you revelation, because he's going to take you to a new place. You have to just sometimes slow down in the Word of God, man. And take it in. It's not how much you read, how much you really understand. Psalm 77:14, thou art the God that doest wonders. Thou hast declared thy strength among thy people. God doesn't change. I was sharing this with somebody. You know, we got to stop saying some of those veteranos. I've been saved 40 years by the grace of God. And we have this nasty habit of saying, well, you know, brother, when I got saved, we were on fire. Man, we used to pray like thunder. We were always on the streets. We were givers. We were planting churches, blah, blah, blah. You telling me God ain't doing that no more? All you're doing is feeding the people you're talking to that it ain't happening. Not me. I'm here to tell you God's about to do it in Jesus' name. I'm about to tell you God's about to plant a church out of this church in Jesus' name. And not just church, but churches in Jesus' name. You will touch foreign soil in Jesus' name. God is going to use some of your kids for missionaries. God's not done yet. What world are you living in? We've limited the holy God of Israel with our unbelief. And how can you go to a foreign nation? How can you go pioneer when your body hurts so bad you can't even move? That's not the will of God. Acts 4:30, by stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of our holy child Jesus. Signs and wonders. It's time for miracles to take place. I'm not against the zeal. I love the zeal that's in this house. But even greater than that, I love the love that's in this house. If I could define the spirit of this church, it's love in Jesus' name. Love is the greatest of all things. You better guard that love. And it starts with your heart. It's not, Lord, help her, Lord. Child, it's you. Shut up, it's you. Help her, Lord. Mensa, it's you. Because if you were right, you'd be on your knees for her. Don't tell me it ain't you. Acts 5:12, and by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. Signs and wonders. Signs and wonders. People are going to come to your services like they do today. They see the power in the praise, man. And I don't know how much you prayed about that day, but you got a lot to live up to. You can't call yourself power and not have any. You better think about that name. You don't want some stranger to come in here into a dead worship service and say, power, this ain't no power. Huh? I see more power at the Dodger game when they won the World Series. No. They got to come in here, listen to me. And they go home. Hey, how was it? How was church? It wasn't church. But I thought you said you were going to go to church. Well, I did, but then what do you mean it wasn't church? It was an encounter. And they'll begin to break right there. They don't care who they're talking to. It was an encounter with God, and my life has been changed. I found my church. Oh, boy, I tell you, if you can grab this, nothing can stop you. Because God's going to show off, and he's going to put this virus in its place. There is a revival coming that's going to make this virus look like shame. Because the way the virus spread, revival's going to spread. The fire's going to spread. Miracles are going to spread. Healings are going to spread. Oh, it's about time for God to move. Psalms 96:3, declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among the people. You know, the world doesn't want to go to church. Because there's nothing new happening in the churches. Same old song and dance. Same old programs. But when they come into the church and the glory of God is in that place. I'm not just talking to the glory. I'm talking the Shekinah glory of God. Oh. Well, you ain't got no choice but to get on your knees. Because you're standing before a holy God. And you have been working at what's happening. This isn't overnight. This isn't overnight. I remember, I don't know what year it was, but I remember I was honored to preach at your conference. It was going deeper. And I sought the Lord and I found a song called Deeper Places. And I played it at that conference. And I was praying for it. And I thought, they're going deep, God. Remove their fears. Because there's always an inadequacy that'll step in. There's always doubt. But we've got to trust you, God. We've got to trust you. See, the world is looking for something to believe in. You know what would happen? Just hear me for a moment. If all these kids that are lost and bound by the spirit of Antifa, if that generation got saved and on fire for God, can you imagine what would happen to this world? If they would get in the streets and do a Jesus march instead of an Antifa march, and then people begin to get saved out there in the street, baptized in the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues. Then miracles starts happening. People start getting healed in these marches. Come on now. We have to start praying. I hate these stupid Antifa people. Lord, curse them. No, Lord, save them. Because they're lost. And the reason they're lost is because they're looking for something they'll never find in the world. It's only found in Jesus. But the church isn't giving them anything to see. You know that old saying, nothing to see here. Child, man, there's a lot to see here. God is doing great things. Can you say amen? In Daniel 6, 19 through 20, then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the lion's den after they had thrown Daniel in. And when he came to the den, he cried and with a lamenting voice unto Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver you from the lions? See, if you read earlier in the chapter, he makes a declaration. Daniel, the God you serve conditionally will deliver you. He will deliver you. He started in faith, but when the day came, like when the altar opens, he went with a question. Has God been able to deliver you? And what does he hear? O king, live forever. And what does the king say? I make a decree in Daniel 6:26 that in every dominion of my kingdom, men will tremble in fear before thy God of Daniel. For he is the living God and steadfast forever. And his kingdom which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. Daniel showed that king and that entire nation who God is. And God is saying, it's time for my church to show the world who I am. That I am the great I am. That I am the all-powerful, wonder-working God. And nothing is too hard for me. How much time do I have, Pastor? So I know I don't want to. Oh, my Father. And you better put your watch away, honey. Luke 24, 1. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. Now, listen. I almost want to tell you, close your eyes and listen, but I won't. But just listen. They came prepared to wrap Jesus' body. They brought spices that they had already prepared. Their minds were prepared to see a dead Jesus. So their actions prove it. They prepared the spices. Oh, they might have been crying. I can't believe my Lord is dead. Whatever. Save those crocodile tears, honey. They prepared the spices for a dead Jesus. Huh? What are you prepared for today? A dead Jesus? Or a risen Savior? Luke 24, 4. And it came to pass as they were much perplexed. Thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments as they were afraid and bowed to their faces to the ground. And they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? What's up with you people? Why have you come to see a dead Jesus? Didn't he tell you he was going to rise again? See, the scripture doesn't say it, but they might have said, we did. He did tell us, but we didn't believe. I'm telling you, God's going to heal you. The question is, will you believe? Will you believe? See, if I say, by his stripes you're healed, you'll say, amen, brother. I believe it. I receive it. He sent his word to heal our diseases. I believe it. No, no, you don't. Can I help you with the problems with the church today? We know too much, and we believe too little. We have all this information that God says he can do, but when it comes time to really living it, where is the fruit? Because you shall know them by their fruits. So then where's the fruit of his wonder-working power in your life? Where's the fruit in your life? You say you believe. And show me something. Knowledge will never heal you. Knowledge is simply information. Jesus didn't go to the cross just to give you knowledge. He went to the cross to give you miracles. Because that's why the cross is empty. And God wants to empty you of your pain today. Huh? We open the altar just a little bit. I'm trying to hurry. But you can't come perplexed. Yeah. Let me say this. Don't come for prayer. I'm begging you. Don't even think about coming. If you're thinking, well, I'm going to go for prayer. Don't come for prayer. You better start talking to yourself right now. I ain't going up for prayer. I'm going up for my miracle. I ain't going up for prayer. I'm going for my breakthrough. I ain't going up for prayer. I've had more than enough prayer. It's time for the manifestation of my prayer to transpire. You got to come with purpose. Like the woman that bled for 12 years. Come on now. Isn't it interesting? If you read the story slow, which we don't, she heard. Jesus was in town. Well, I don't know. What did she hear? Doesn't say in that story. But if you read the chapters before, about 6 or 7 miracles took place. A leper got healed. Come on. A lame man got healed. Maybe someone was saying, did you hear what happened? Did you hear what happened? So her faith was being built like yours is being built right now. Her faith was being built. All for that one time, that divine intervention, that divine moment when it was her time. And she wasn't going to let it pass her by. She had been bleeding for 12 years. She was so weak she couldn't stand. Someone gave it to me on DVD and she's so weak, man, and frail. And the Levitical law deemed her to shout, unclean, unclean, even more knowing Jesus was coming. She should have prepared her mind, her voice to shout unclean. Well, the Bible says that's not what she said. There was a shifting in her mind to a miracle mentality that said, oh, if I touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. And the DVD puts it so beautiful because Jesus walks past her. Ooh. You know, sometimes he'll pass you by. You know why? He wants to know how desperate you really are. He knows you're there. He knows you're hurting. But he'll go right past you. You can either get insulted and say, what's up with that? You can say, oh no, you ain't getting away from me. If I gotta crawl, I'm gonna crawl. And so this video is so powerful because she's so weak, she can't stand on her own. And nobody cares. But God does. If he didn't, he wouldn't have walked in front of her. He passes her by on purpose. She can't stand, so she starts to crawl. Mm-mm-mm. Say, Pastor, you know, you're an evangelist. How come miracles don't happen like they happen in third world countries? Well, simple, they don't have Medi-Cal. We won't admit it, but we trust more in Medi-Cal than we do his word. Well, I better go get checked. How about I better get on my knees and trust God to heal me in Jesus' name? Come on. We're such sissies. Oh, do you have the virus? Your mama has a virus. I ain't got no virus. Do you have the virus? I don't know what your prayer is, but I tell you, every time I'm in a new church, Lord, I rebuke that virus. It will not come into this temple. And it's sure ain't going to come into our hearts and our minds and in our bodies. In Jesus' name, we're going to trust you. We're going to trust you. Come on, we're going to trust you. And we're doing, they check my temperature. Come on now. And they said, brother, you're hot. I said, it's the Holy Ghost, brother. That ain't nothing abnormal now. That's just the fire of God. But I'm here to tell you, man, you cannot come over here perplexed. Got to come with a purpose. Purpose is a reason for which something exists or is done, made or used. It is an intended or desired result, end, aim, or goal. It's determination and resoluteness. You better not come up here with doubt. Or you might as well stay in your seat. Because you're the reason why you're not going to get healed, not God. God wants to move today. He promised me he was going to move today. I said he promised me he was going to move today. Perplexed, bewildered, confused, puzzled over what is not as understood or certain of. Confusion or uncertainty. They went to the sepulcher and they left perplexed. What's going on here? It's a powerful story of unbelief on the resurrection day. In Luke 24, 11, 12, and their words, they go and they tell them that Jesus is alive. Come on now. And their words seem to them as idle tales, and they believe them not. Then Peter arose and ran into the sepulcher, and stooping down and beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and he departed, wondering in himself, at what had come to pass. Here's a guy who walked with him for 3.5 years. Walks on water. Jesus tells him what he's going to do. And when it happens, he goes and he sees it empty and he leaves going, I wonder what happened. Huh? I wonder. He didn't jump in the temple.
Come on, come on.
He didn't jump in the sepulcher. And say, thank you, Lord. He's alive. He's alive. Death and hell couldn't hold my Jesus. He's alive. No, he left with his head down. I wonder what that was all about. God's moving in this place. And you know what's the trip? You know, he moves in our hearts most of the time. But today he's moving in your mind. And your mind is shifting. And it's saying, that's heavy, man. I thought it was just a story of the resurrection. I never knew it was a story of unbelief. Because that's what it is. The women came prepared to bury him. And when they went and told the story, they laughed. You're crazy. Then when Peter goes, he walks away tripping. Wow. Huh. I wonder if someone stole the body. Come on now. That was a liar. Huh? How about giving God the praise? Now let me hurry because I want to open the altars. You need to go home and study this scripture when you get home. Luke chapter 24. So the Bible says that after Jesus raises from the dead, he decides to take a walk. Come on now. And he runs into two guys on the road to Emmaus. And he said unto them, what manner of communication are these that you have one to another as you walk and are sad? We're not talking about you're shouting. He's alive! He's alive! Oh, thank you, Jesus! What is this manner of communication that you're having with one another and you're so sad? Luke 24, 21. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Nothing has happened. See, you're going to come up, some of you, for your healing. Some of you aren't going to get it today. But you might get it when you get out of your car, when you get home. Huh? The question is, will you allow the devil to lie to you? My neck's been hurting, man. I'm going to go for my neck. And you get in your car and you go, man, my neck still hurts. I guess God didn't heal me. Ah, whatever. I love you anyway, Lord. Shut up. What am I basing it on? I prayed for a girl one time, and she came to the altar. She was like this. Come on. She wasn't dancing. It was in Pastor Henry's church. She was like this. And I said, what's wrong with you? I said, I'll tell you what's wrong with you. You backslid. And you allowed someone to put a curse on you. But God's about to set you free. So I'm going to pray for you. You're going to stop shaking in Jesus' name. Please listen. I pray for her. Like all men, you want to believe. I opened my eyes and she's like this still. And I said, look at me, honey. You're healed. But you have to get the victory up here. Are you listening to me? Because God has healed you. But you have to fight for this healing. You go home and get on your knees and you say, I will not receive this in Jesus' name. I've been set free. I go back about a month later to preach. And she comes up to me. You know you forget sometimes, people, I'm sorry to say. And she goes, hi, Pastor. Hey, sis, how are you? How do I look? And I go, you look good, sis. No, how do I look? I go, you look good, sis. No, I mean, how do I look? And I go, you know, I'm married, honey. I don't know what you want me to look at. But I'm married. I don't blame you. Because I know I'm so fine, I blow my own mind. She says, no, Pastor, you're not paying attention. Look, 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 I'm not shaking anymore. I went and did what you told me. And I woke up. And I'm brushing my teeth. And I went like this. And I started to cry because I wasn't doing this. I was doing this. See, some of you ain't shouting because you ain't never gotten a miracle before. I'm going to tell you, once you get a miracle, you just open the door. And they're just going to follow. They're going to follow. They're going to follow. They're going to follow. I'm telling you, God's moving. I was at a conference in El Centro before this thing hit. And I go to a Denny's, and I see a pastor from Oxnard. And I go up, we're going to say, hey, Pastor, how are you? And the guy says, hey, Pastor. I go, what's up, brother? He goes, I don't know if you remember me, but, man, I had a bad back. You prayed for me, and God healed my back, brother. I go, well, praise God, brother. So I go to my room, and I drove through McDonald's, and I got me my burger and my fries and my Diet Coke so I don't gain no weight. Stop it, sister. And I'm getting ready to put the card in, and I hear someone go, Pastor Rudy. And I look, and it's the pastor I preached for in Yuma, Arizona. Him and his wife and his kids. His wife, they told her, before the virus, she needed new lungs. And so I see them, and I go, hey, how are you guys? Like, we knew you were here. I go, how? Because we saw your name on one of the chairs. I go, oh, okay. How are you guys? Oh, good, good. And I go, how are you, sis? She starts crying. She goes, not good, Pastor. I'm having trouble breathing. And I said, you know what, sis? I don't have the power of telepathy. I cannot take you back to Denny's 10 minutes ago where a gentleman told me God healed his back. Now, I am moving in the direction of healing. I know it. It hasn't broke yet. It's going to break, but it's breaking slowly. And if you'd let me, I'd love to pray for you because God made the lungs. He'll give you new lungs in Jesus' name. And if you'll let me, I'll pray for you. Prayed for her. She got slain in the Holy Ghost on the parking lot. And her lungs are doing well in Jesus' name. I'm trying to tell you, God is moving. Can you say amen? Luke 24, 25, 26. Jesus said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe. All the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? He did not suffer for us to suffer. Yeah, I know there's areas of our life where we'll go through some things. I've dealt with it myself. I'm talking about the suffering in your body, man. God wants to heal you. And quit lying to yourself. I know there's a lot of young people, and God bless you. But, man, when you get old and your body starts hurt, don't accept it. You know, we're so foolish. You go, hey, could you pray for my grandma? How old is she? 95. Oh, come on, dude. Really? She's ready to go. She's got one foot on the grave and one on the banana peel. Let her go. Let her go. She's old. Accept it. She dyes her hair blue. Let her go. This is where the miracles happen. He rebukes them. He rebukes them. He calls them fools and slow of heart to believe. Ought not Christ to have suffered to enter into his glory? And then they drew nigh unto a village in Luke 24, 29. And where they went, he was made as he, listen, Jesus made as though he would have gone further, or he pretended like he was going to go that way. They hit a fork in the road, and Jesus goes, okay, guys, I'm going this way. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. Now, get this. Pastor, why don't miracles happen? Why did I ask your pastor how much time I have? Because today, God's going to ask you to wait. To come to this altar and wait. And wait. And wait. See, he was getting ready to go, but they said, no, we can't let him go. See, some of you, you're in his presence and you let him go. Don't let him go. What are you afraid of? I have my fears like you do. Come on now. There's times that I prayed and I feel, you know, something I never felt. But I know it's God. Come on. I was at a church in El Centro and I prayed for 700 people. Man, I was tired. And then when I'm done, they come up to me and go, Pastor, ¿hablas español? They go, sí, cómo no. Well, we didn't get no prayer. Well, bring them. I prayed for the whole Spanish congregation. 10:30 at night on a Wednesday. Then the youth pastor comes and says, Pastor, will you pray for our youth? I go, sure, bring them. See, people aren't dumb. They know when God is there. And they constrain him. Pastor, don't go. We got more people that need prayer. Pastor, don't go. People aren't dumb. They see what God is doing. I said, we'll bring them. They brought 19 kids. I charged them to live right and to love one another. And I said, because of time, Pastor Tony's going to take me home. I'm going to pray for you, but I'm going to do something different. You're going to join hands. I'm going to pray for you. Close your eyes. And when I clap my hands, I've never done this before. When I clap my hands, the power of God is going to hit you. Are you guys ready? Are you guys ready? Are you guys ready? I clap my hands and all the kids went, pow! I went to my room and I cried. And I said, Lord, where are you taking me? I'm afraid. Because I don't want to turn your church into a circus. You need to tell me, was that you? Because I need to know. So I called a pastor who I respect on Monday. And I'm like a little baby. I'm crying. Pastor, I got to talk to you. What's going on, brother? Well, this happened. And he gave me a Holy Ghost answer. I don't know what to tell you. Thank you, brother. You bless me. So I hang up, and I'm crying. I don't know what to do, Lord. I mean, I'm crying. I'm really weeping. Then he calls me right back. Brother Rudy. Yes, Pastor. Did God tell you to do that? I go, yes, he did. Then you did the right thing. But don't ever do it again unless he tells you to do it again. I've never done it again because he's never told me to do it again. It was a one-time thing. But I'm telling you, God's beginning to unleash his power. Constrain means to force or to compel or to oblige, to confine forcibly as by bonds, to repress or to restrain, to put a demand on. God wants you to come today, put a demand on his anointing. Not telling you to come and say, I demand you to heal me, but I want you to come out here, pour your heart out, be like Jacob. Can you say amen? I ain't going to let you go unless you heal me. I ain't going to let you go unless you bless me. Can you say amen? Come on, I'm done. Give the Lord a praise. We're going to do things a little different today. And just be open if you can for a moment. We're almost done. I'm going to go through some listings of some infirmities. And I just want to help you. If you have arthritis, I don't think you have to look at your wife and go, do I have arthritis? You know if you have it. Come on now. Come on. If you have gas, come on now. Do I have gas? Orale, vato. Come on. I heard the cloud of glory, but that's a different cloud. So what I'm saying is I'm going to call something out. If you have it, don't wait. Get out of your seat and come. Don't talk to nobody. Don't ask nobody. As the worship team comes, just come. Just come, just come. And don't wait for anybody. You just start getting on your knees. You stand. You can prostrate. Whatever. Just cry out to God. Can you say amen? And get your miracle. And I'm talking physical, mental, emotional. So if you have any type of cancer, you've been diagnosed with any type of cancer, come on. Whether it's breast or prostate or skin or stomach or liver cancer. God healed a guy from liver cancer in one of my services already. So I declare to you, God can heal. If you've been diagnosed with any type of cancer, come, get out of your seat, run. If you have any type of heart trouble, any type of heart trouble, come, get out of your seat. Don't ask anybody. Come. Come. Thank you. If you have kidney problems, especially the